missed what he said, so I know Pastor Atul. He's a great friend. Good evening, everyone. And good evening to the people who are in the court of Gentiles. Okay. So, open to Philippians chapter 4. Ten-minute messages are very hard for me. And I got some good news before coming. I can take some liberties, I guess. Okay, Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. The theme of our conference is, in my words, preparation of a man or woman of God for the work of God. And I have been thinking about this aspect of our life with God, which is our thought life, our meditation. And I believe that this is an important aspect of our life as a servant of God. And Philippians chapter 4 verse 8. We'll pray a prayer before we read this verse. Dear Father, we are so blessed to be in this conference, and every person present in this conference has a ministry towards our soul, and we have received it. It's been so amazing, and you have been speaking to us. We have sensed your presence, and at this moment we ask you to just bless this portion, edify us, speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. These are the kind of things which are the content of the mind of a believer. Now, I remember when I came to church 13 years back, it's been a long time, I didn't realize that years have passed. I came here as an unbeliever right in this room, and I didn't have any clue at all about who God is and what is the meaning of life, what's the purpose, why are we here after all. And my thought life was messed up. I can say that very clearly. I was a 28-year-old young man, and my thought life was messed up. But we receive Christ in our lives. And Bible says we have the mind of Christ. And we have a content now of our thinking. And these are the things. Whatever is true, truth. Truth is the content of our thinking. But, you know, a lot of times somebody would say, like you have heard this phrase, like in Hindi they say, Sachai kadvi hoti hai, right? Like truth is bitter, they say, right? But in the word of God, this comes in the list of good things. Like truth is going to be sweet to me, right? Like Psalm 19 verses 9 and 10. Like, your word is like honey, the psalmist says. Like, how does truth become like honey to me? You know, our children, like especially my son, he has to take a lot of medication. Like, he just sneezes so quickly, you know. And we had to give him a lot of, you know, those cough syrups all the way, and like there has been a lot of resistance, like this is bitter, this is bitter. But you need to have it because this is medicine, right? So what to do? So as parents, you figure out tricks, right? And one of the tricks is, we'll give you sugar. You have this bitter medicine and we'll give you sugar that will compensate for it, right? I need sugar in my... And word of God may correct me, right? But it will also become sugar. It will also become honey in my mouth. And, you know, we learn to meditate. We learn to, like, there are other things in this verse. It says, whatever things are honest. Another word there is whatever things are, like, venerable. Like, some, like what do I meditate on? It's not just the verses, right? It's not like, today we were free in the afternoon, we had a group of people, and we were like, we said, look, let's see how we can learn to meditate on the Word of God. And I think many years back, somebody taught me, I had this question, like, how do I meditate on the Word? We ask ourselves questions as we read the Word of God. And then we go before God, and Holy Spirit is involved, and He, like, there is a conversation going on, and we get answers as we read the Word of God, and then we take those answers back to God, and we praise Him for those answers, and that's amazing. Like, this process takes the Word of God, and like, it makes me rich within my soul. That's meditation. It makes me productive. It makes me like a man, like the tree in Psalm 1 verse 3, like, which bears fruit. Like, the fruit does not begin at the mission field. The fruit begins in my closet. I worship the Lord as I study. Like, I was thinking of this. To me, worship and the Word of God are so intricately interrelated. Like, it's hard for me to worship without the Word. Like, you know, I love the songs, like the words of the songs when I'm singing them, and they kind of remind me of the verses from the Bible. Somehow, it's not the music so much. I love the music, and thank you for the awesome music which we have. But you know what? As I worship, in my mind, like, there's a connection with the Word of God. And as I study the Word of God, I worship. Like, I learn the Word, and I then go back to God and I say, how awesome you are. Like, I'm learning about you. This is amazing. So whatever things are just, right? He's righteous, and He has made me righteous. Like, I read the Word like that. The Word does not condemn me, right? Like, the Word, like, I have met believers who read the Word of God, and they say, I must do this. And I know there is an aspect of that in our life that I like, Holy Spirit convicts me. But then I love to read the Word in this way. You have made me righteous. You have loved me with an everlasting love. You have sent your Son to die for me on the cross. Your grace is unending for me. You have made me accepted in the Beloved. Like, that's the way it ministers to me. Whatever is just, and whatever things are lovely. You know, whatever things are of good report, whatever is, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise. You know, Ezekiel chapter 3 verse 3. Ezekiel was told by God to eat the scroll. And it says, scroll went up to the bowels. And then he says, it became like honey in my mouth. You know, like how do I meditate on the Word of God? You know, one of the close illustrations, we have a lot of cows in India, right? We can make some cow illustration. We can learn from them a little bit. You know how they eat? When they go in the fields where they are grazing, they eat grass. They are very quick. You know, their mouth is active. And they take in a lot, you know, in, like very fast. And then they go back and find a place of rest. And there, they have a mechanism in their body that this food which is eaten gets stored somewhere and they bring it back to mouth. And then this is called ruminating. In Hindi we call it jugali karna. You know, and it comes back into their mouth and then just chew it again. You know? And you know, I remember some of my doctor uncles in the childhood days advising me, you know what? You are thin because there is a reason. I never learned it anyway. They said, if you chew your food enough and if you eat slow, you will gain weight. I never followed the advice. You know, the healthy weight, okay? And they said, you will enjoy the food because it will taste better in your mouth. So the cows ruminate. And we believers can also ruminate. We are here in the conference taking a lot in, right? And then we go back and we find a place of rest. Jesus said, when you pray, you go into the closet and shut the door. And then you bring that back in your mouth and you chew on it. And this will taste like honey. This is going to, you know, this will bring healing like the medicine, but it will not, it will also remove the bitterness. I was reading one passage this morning, 1 Kings chapter 19. This is Elijah. You know, God spoke to him and he was asked to anoint 3 men. I should say this right now before I get into this passage. You know, I'm a pastor in Navi Mumbai and I never imagined in my life, I never had an ambition to be a pastor, but God calls us. And as we do this, we recognize the value of what it means. And today there are quite a few folks from Navi Mumbai, they have come in here, and today I was telling to them in our wrap in the canteen today, you know, I'm so blessed. I'm really proud as a pastor to see your lives. Because you are here. Like many of them have just moved into this area. And thank you for opening. Many people in the body of Christ open their homes for them. Thank you for doing that. I said, you know what? 3.5 years into the church planting, you are a joy of my heart. You know why? You are so hungry for the Word. This is what I wanted. Like, you know, there are many other things in church planting, the details, the administration and the size of the church and the hall you rent and all that and your weekly schedules. To me, this is most important. You are hungry for God. You are hungry for the Word. This is amazing. And I said to them, I can go anywhere. Like if God leads me to the next church plant, I can go because I have seen your lives. This is amazing. This is so encouraging to me. I love this, you know. And people get hungry for the Word of God. They learn to think with the mind of Christ. This means a lot externally, which we are not even talking about right now. I remember Pastor Shala mentioned in one of these messages, like, who is sufficient for these things, right? And he says, this room filled with people, the professor in the Mumbai University cannot do it, right? Like, the politicians of our country cannot do this. But the Word of God, men of God who learn this, this happens. You know, many months back, somebody came to me. They said, Pastor, I need marriage counseling. I said, okay. We do this, that's not a problem. But I don't do it so often. But they said, Pastor, I've heard that quite a few testimonies in our church about marriages getting healed. I said, really? And you have counseled them. And they told me names. And I recognized what they were talking about. But you know what? I told them, and this was plain truth. I said, you know what? I didn't counsel any of those people whose names you are mentioning. And I know their situation, and I know what has happened. But you know what counseled them? The pulpit. We were preaching the word. And we kept on preaching the word. We met at the parks. We kept on preaching the word. We learned to meditate together. We paused and we said, let us open the Bible. And let's think, what this does this mean? And we kept on doing this over and over again. And we didn't counsel them. The word of the Lord. This makes things beautiful. This makes things beautiful. Like, there are crooked things happening. Like, our minds are like that. You know what? Most of our problems are connected with our mind. Somebody said this. They said, the strongest sex organ in our body is our mind. You realize that? Like, that's why Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, you have heard this, that the murder, but then I say unto you, if you think an angry thought, it's as good as that. Because it all begins in the mind. And if the Lord wants to change the way we think, and He is changing us, and He is teaching us, and that's why I learned this discipline of meditation. Because I am a man or a woman of God, right? 1 Kings 19, verse 17, God gave him the promise, Elijah. He says, and it shall come to pass that him that escapes the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. If you know the history, in the 2 Kings chapter 8, 9, 10, 11, this came to pass. Hazael, the king of Syria, came and attacked Israel, and he slayed a lot of people. And then Jehu came, and Jehu, you know, wiped out the, you know, Baal worship and everything. But you know what? Something which I kept on looking in my Bible and I didn't find. Elisha coming with a sword. I didn't find it. But this prophecy says, like, whatever is left over from Jehu and Hazael, it will be killed by Elisha. So what kind of sword is Elisha carrying? Hosea chapter 6, verse 5. God gives the explanation. Okay, this is my last. Hosea chapter 6, verse 5. Therefore have I hewed them by the prophets. I have slain them by the words of my mouth. And your judgments are as the light that goes forth. So the words of the mouth, from the mouth of the prophet, God is saying it's a sword. This is amazing. I don't want to be Hazel or Jehu. I have the sword of Elisha. Hebrews 4:12. The word of God is a double-edged sword, right? And it's living. And it's quick. It's powerful. And it goes deep. There's a beautiful picture, you know. Like sword is otherwise a negative picture. Why would God come to me with a sword, right? Like it almost seems like what's the idea behind it? It penetrates. The Lord needs His sword so that He can penetrate through me. Like deep within me. Like it goes like really deep. You know? And I need it. He tells me about Himself. And it's alive. It's dynamic. He comes to me for that moment. I need Him today, maybe in a way which is different from the way I needed Him yesterday. There are areas of my life which He may be dealing with today which are different than yesterday. And the Word of God is dynamic. You may read the same words today, and you will. We were teaching this while we were doing that meditation exercise today. We said, you know what? There are 15 different answers. We were giving them, you know, just questions, and then read the portion, and then try and answer that question in your own mind. And you can have a list of questions to help you in the meditation. You can make a list of 15 questions and then read any portion of the scripture and ask those, what is the attribute of God which I see here in this portion? Like, what is that scripture from my recent past which this portion reminds me of? Like, you can have your own questions. And then there are different answers. And I said, that it's all right that you have different answers. Because that's the way it works. That's how dynamic the Word of God is. He will speak to you differently like than your neighbor. It's all right. It will be very, very personal also. Song of Solomon chapter 1 verse 2 says, you kiss me with the kisses of your mouth. It's like address to God. He is our beloved, He loves us, and then He kisses us with the kisses of His mouth. They come to us over and over again, and they speak His love towards us. And He does it. And it's so personal. It's so personal. It's the same word, but we read it, and He speaks to us differently than the way He's speaking to my neighbor. We are sitting in this room and we are listening to the same messages. But Lord meets us where we are in our lives. And we take this word back and we don't lose it. We don't lose it quickly. We recognize that this needs to come back to my mouth. This needs to be brought to the top. Like before I go to sleep, I can make a practice in my life to think about my whole day and how many times the kisses of God came into my life. How many times kisses means He speaks, kisses come from His mouth. Right? How many times did God initiate a conversation to me and I heard something? And I don't want to lose it, so before I go to sleep, maybe I'll give 5 minutes to remember. What did He speak to me in my devotion this morning? And did I hear a message and something minister to me and I bring it back? And then maybe If I feel ministered and I say, Lord, I'm going on my knees and lifting my hands and saying thank you to you because you kissed me. Right? Amen.
In 2007, through a friend, we met Pastor Pradeep Hema, a fully trained Bible college student with a passionate burning desire to reach out to the people of the state of Orissa. In 2009, our prayers were answered. Pastor Pradeep found an ideal location in a place called Raigada on the western end of Orissa. After much prayer and consideration, we chose 11 committed men who are undergoing a 3-year Bible training course in mission church planting. These men already had work in Orissa's deep and unreached places, but had very little encouragement and Bible training. Greater Grace Fellowship has decided to train and support the first batch for the next 3 years, and then send them out with the goal to reach out and plant churches in all 26 districts of Orissa, under the able leadership of Pastor Pradeep. The training center, now based in Raigada, has a program which includes Bible teaching, weekly evangelism, house Bible studies, visits, and trips into the unreached places to preach the gospel. In spite of the intense persecution, the gospel has penetrated deep into the remote parts of Orissa. A place called Rindabali, where there is no paved road. No water connection. No electricity. But here you find a church of 90 people, hungry for the word. In Biringia, we find the deacon's home burned down. But the church goes on, rejoicing in the midst of affliction. These are just 3 accounts of the existing 9 churches of Greater Grace Orissa. We have 5 churches in the persecuted Kandamal and 4 churches in Raigada, all rejoicing in the freedom they've found in Christ. And that's the story of Orissa, hard-pressed yet not crushed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not forsaken, struck down but not destroyed.
Justice and grace become my embrace. such a great message from Pastor Devendra. I was in the overflow room and enjoying it. It was a great sound, that one room, and it just was, you know, the message was awesome. It was really so good, wasn't it? It was such a good message. And tonight I'd like you to turn with me to John chapter 13. And many of us know the story of Christ washing the feet of the disciples. But we may not think so much of the story behind it and why it was done and who Christ was, what he was thinking as he was teaching his disciples a very important lesson. We heard from Pastor Devendra that our mind is very important in our life. We are born again and we are given the mind of Christ. So now we think in a different way. There is the natural way of thinking that we have by our genetics, by our upbringing, by our education, and by our fallen nature. And because of our fallen nature, many times our thinking is driven by self-interest and also insecurity. Jealousy is an evidence of that fallen image that we have. But because we've been born again, we have a whole new capacity, and that is to think without jealousy, without envy, without bitterness. We're able to speak in a new way from our heart and also to love in 1 Corinthians in chapter 13. We read about love. So we were lost at one time and natural. But then we heard the gospel and believed. The people in Orissa that we just saw on the video is amazing. And you think, what happened with these people? Why are they singing? Why are they dancing? Why are they convinced and persuaded? But because Christ said, I came for them. I've given them the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit has affected their hearts. I could imagine one of them believed in Jesus, and the next morning when they woke up, they weren't guilty. And they felt this freedom, and they worshiped and said, Abba, Father. I can imagine the people in the jungle, far away, with a very little understanding in some ways, but angry with a neighbor or a child, or disappointed with themselves, maybe the death of a loved one. And they have so many questions in their heart. And then the peace of God that passes understanding comes into the heart. And they say, Jesus is amazing. Jesus is real. I believe in him. He is kissing me with the kisses of his mouth. They wouldn't use that language, but that is what is happening in their lives. We are amazed at that. And we speak about it and learn about it. And that is why the Apostle Paul was so important to him when he wrote his epistles. And he would say to Timothy and to Titus and the Corinthians and the Philippians and the Ephesians, he would teach them and say, you must be built up. You must be edified in your faith. You cannot be cheated, we said this morning, by the Pharisees, the leaven of the Pharisees, the leaven of the Sadducees. We said these are legalistic people and these are liberal, unbelieving believers. The Sadducees were skeptics, men of the age of reason, and also indifferent to the spiritual life. Both of those made up the Sanhedrin. Jesus knew within 40 years both parties would be gone. The temple would be destroyed, and Israeli living would change as the Romans broke their rebellion and drove them out of the country. But Jesus knew, though Phariseeism would be gone and Sadduceeism would be gone, the principle would not be gone. The legalism would continue with other names, and the Sadduceeism would continue with other names. This cannot affect us, adulterate our doctrine, and change our pure and simple faith in Christ. So we have this principle of spiritual edification. Turn to Jude with me for one portion there. The Bible schools teach us edification. I think Pastor Carl is one of the most edifying people I know. Just how he loves people and edifies. I think much of what we see here is because of edification. And it is deep. I can say to Pastor Fred, I can say his name, and that is edifying. And I could also say something kind. Pastor Fred, I like to be with you, and that is also edifying, and those are good words. But there's something else he needs more than me to know his name and say something kind. He needs a deep edification, a spiritual impartation. This is what happens in the church. God edifies us on a deep level. And this is here, Jude verse 20. Would you read it with me? But you, beloved, stop there. Go to 19. These be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. The context is that he's been speaking about people that have departed. People in a deep way have departed from the faith. Even he's saying maybe they weren't believers at all. They have not the Spirit in verse 19. So it's all pretty negative. There's seven metaphors here in this chapter of these people. Trees without fruit, clouds without water, waves of the sea, wandering stars. In conclusion, verse 19, they have not the Spirit. But you, verse 20, would you read it? But you, beloved, building up yourselves in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Think of the people in Orissa, praying in the Holy Spirit, building up themselves in the most holy faith, receiving apostolic teaching. That means we are not apostles, but the teaching is apostolic, meaning it's right here in our epistles. It's right here in the Bible. Apostolic teaching is able to build you up. Apostolic doctrine from the Bible is able to open your heart and your mind and your understanding. It is able to build you up so you know you have eternal life. There are many believers that do not know they are believers, but they do not know they have eternal life because they feel guilty. They live in some unbelief. They don't know the Bible. There is not a fellowship of edification. We may know their name, but there's another third level. Hi, Pastor Fred. Nice to be with you. But I'd like you, do you know? Have you understood? Have you fellowshipped with the reality that you, sir, have eternal life? And you are a child of God. Jesus said, rejoice in this. Your name is written in the book of life. We have the book of the Bible. We don't have the book of life. God has the book of life. But he says what you need to know about the book. Your name is there. That's all you need to know. We don't study the book of life. We study the Bible. But he tells you your name is in the book of life. That's deeply edifying. And this is how Jesus washed the feet. Would you turn to John 13, please? Jesus washed the feet. And these are the opening words. Verse 1. Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. That verse has many elements there. Listen, he knew his hour was come. He had lived an amazing life. He had done great things in his life, in the last part of his life. He had amazing mission and amazing purpose. Now was the tough part. All of it was challenging to him, but now he is going to die for the sins of the world. And he knew that this was the time. He knew he would leave the world, and it says here, he would go to the Father, and he knew that. I will go to the Father. This means that he saw more than the Roman government, more than the disciples' personality. He saw more than economics or the weather. He understood more than just the cross that he would one day hang upon. He knew more than just the blood that would be shed. He knew more about what was happening than anybody ever knew before they faced such an end. He knew he would go to the Father, guaranteed. He was sure about it because of Psalm 16 says it. Psalm 110 says it also. Psalm 45 as well, and Psalm 40. So it says then, he loved them, and he loved them unto the end. He loved them. He loved these men that were at the supper. He had love in his mind. He knew them. He loved them unto the end. He knew their weaknesses. He knew their problems. He knew their failures. But he loved them unto the end. He never stopped loving them. He did not judge them. He loved them. He edified them. And he taught them. And he incredibly believed that his Father would do this, just like we believe in Orissa. God is doing that work in Orissa. In the same way, even more so, Jesus had many reasons to doubt the future of this small flock. Verse 2, there's another mind there. The supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. There's a mind there at the table. The mind is different from Jesus' mind. And it came from Satan. And it was in Judas' heart, in his mind. I was paid the other day 30 pieces of silver. In our money today, it would be $150. $150 for a very poor person is a lot of money. But today, money has changed. It's not that much money anymore. Judas was paid not a lot of money. He was paid relatively little money for what he is now going to do. And he's thinking, now I'm out of here. Now I have a little bit of money for it. And now I'm going to go get the priests. And this is my opportunity. He was looking for the opportunity. And it's interesting, in my mind, if it's in my mind, I will find the opportunity. And if it's Jesus' mind, he will find another opportunity. Jesus will find the opportunity to wash the feet and to teach his disciples and edify them. And in the other mind, there's an opportunity to betray him, to lie to him, to cheat him. There's an opportunity to betray his friend, his familiar friend. This can happen to us, though I don't believe that the devil can come into our heart. Here it looks like, this is interesting. Pastor, could you stand up for a second? Let's say Pastor Atul is Jesus. Where does the devil want to be? Here is Jesus, and where does the devil want to be? I think the devil could be far away, but I also think the devil looks for the opportunity to get as close to Jesus as he can. And this is Judas now, and the devil comes in to Judas, and Judas is right there, as close to him as he can. To lie to him, to mock him, to betray him. What a picture that is. I think when you have the work of God, it's only a matter of time before in the work of God, the devil may be far away, but it's his plan to, when there's wheat, at night come and plant a tare right next to the wheat. When Moses is born, it is the idea is to throw him in the river. When Adam and Eve are in the garden, Adam and Eve are in the paradise garden, and it's the devil that wants to go in the garden and get as close to what God is doing, and to lie and cheat and destroy. But Jesus has another mind. He's not part of the devil. And he said at the Last Supper, what you do, go and do quickly. So he's gone. And Jesus continues in his great work. Because the mind of Christ is not polluted by the work of evil. The mind of Christ is moving in the plan of God. And there's a plan. And Jesus is saying, I will teach them something. Thank you very much. I will teach them something. And this is the edification that comes to Pastor Fred. When he is edified, he is now part of something that is bigger than the devil, though the devil may come very close. But Pastor Fred is part of something that's bigger than the work of evil, bigger than the temptation and the lie and the twisted thinking. Verse 3. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands. That means Jesus knows he's very, very honored by the Father and has given everything into his hands. Jesus knew this. He was victorious even before the cross happened. He knew he was victorious, and the Father had given everything into his hands, and that he was come from God and he went to God. Jesus knew this. Listen to this. Pastor Arpit said it this morning. We must know our new identity. Maybe we were good at understanding our old identity, but even that was really some kind of a lie. But in our new identity, this is the identity that we embrace and we learn. And in that new identity, I know that I came from God and I returned to God. And that God has put everything into our hands, Christ's hands. So, Pastor Fred, do you know? We could say, where'd you come from? You know what the scientists may say, some of them. Where do they think Fred came from, Pastor Fred? He's an accident. He looks like an accident. He looks like he's been in an accident. He's an accident. Haven't you heard the theory of evolution? That is chance. There is no plan. There is no design. This information just happened. Just came. It just happened. There's no explanation. They just live in the denial of this transcendental intelligence. This incredible belief in a God that is bigger than his creation. So he doesn't believe that. Pastor Fred, do you know that? Where did you come from? He was born again, so he came from God. If you're not born again, you may say, I came from my mother and my father. But when you are born again, you say you came from God. And then where are you going? I'm going to the store. I'm going to the school. Or even I'll go further, I'm going to the grave. Oh no, I'm not going to the grave. I'm going to God. I came from God and I returned from God. And on the basis of this mentality, Christ is able to go very low and weigh down and serve, love, wash, be a servant. In the Jewish Seder, this was the Passover feast, rabbinical tradition had it this way. When they ate the Passover meal, they would wear like nice clothes and like a crown on their head, a big hat. And they do it today in Orthodox Judaism. And when they come to the table, they kind of show their clothes. And they say this, we once were slaves in Egypt with nothing, but God brought us out of Egypt and he's made us kings and he's honored us. And he did it by the lamb that was slain in Egypt and the blood on the doorpost, and he brought us out. And it's very possible at the Last Supper, this was like it was a Passover meal, and we don't have details, but the Jewish people could be proud that I came out of Egypt, and they would wear like these dresses decorated and ornamented, and they would be like kind of saying, we are not slaves, we are honorable. Well, Jesus breaks away from that, and he girds himself with a towel, and he is down on the floor with the feet in his hands, and he's washing them. This is in verse 4. He rises from supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel, girded himself. Peter calls this being girded with humility. The mind of Christ can afford to be you're so low and humble. Because look at, he came from God. He returns to God, and everything is in his hands. Why can't I wash the feet? Why can't I be clothed with humility? If I am so rich spiritually, then can't I be a servant spiritually also? And say, I forgive you to somebody who has hurt me. To say, can I help you to somebody that I don't like? It's funny the way we are as people. We love everyone because we have God's mind. But then there are things that happen between us. There are little things that disturb us. There are little jealousies and envies. There are words spoken that maybe shouldn't have been spoken. There are things that have never been said that should have been said. Like maybe the words, I love you. But they've never been said. And it might be hard for me to say them. But Jesus is saying, you must care and must wash one another's feet. In his verse 5, after he poureth water into a basin, he began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter said unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Jesus said, what I do you know not now, but you will know hereafter. And that's an important lesson for us. Maybe now I don't understand it, but later I will understand it. Maybe now I have a little idea of what is happening, but maybe later I'll look back and say, thank God I did that. Thank God I was part of that. Thank God I believed that. Thank God I listened. Thank God. And when I started to go to church, I did not know what it would really mean to me. But now when I look back, I say, thank God that I went to the church. Thank God I bought a Bible and opened it up. Thank God I learned to pray. Thank God I learned to meditate. Thank God I learned to edify. Thank God I learned to come to somebody and say, I not only know your name, and I not only like to be with you, but I also like the fellowship because I know that you and I have come from God and we will also go back to God. And that God has put everything into our hands, and we are on a mission, and we have a purpose that is bigger than ourselves. Verse 8, Peter said, you will not, never, never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, you will never, you listen to me, Jesus. You will never wash my feet. Never. See what's going on here. Peter, in his mind, he's not yet understanding. He does not yet know. He is learning. And he's a great example for us because he is so transparent, spontaneous, impulsive, and he kind of says out loud what many of us may be thinking. And he says, you will never wash my feet. If I wash you not, you have no part with me, Jesus said. You must let me wash your feet. And if you do not, I have nothing to do with you, because this relationship is this one. I must save you. I must serve you. I must kiss you with the kisses of my mouth. I must give you the word. I must impart my life to you. I must teach you prayer because you don't know what it is. I must forgive you of your sin all the time because you don't know what your sin really is and how much you have of it. But I forgive you, and you must learn to let me wash you. Simon Peter said unto him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Why did he say that? I want you in my life so much. Don't ever say, if I don't wash your feet, I have nothing to do with you. Oh no, please do not go away from me. Be close to me. Wash my feet, my head, my hands. Wash me all over. I need you more than anything. I've learned to love you. I've learned to listen to you. You've changed my life. You are so important to me. I give you everything. I put all my trust in you. And Jesus then explained to him, and we'll skip that. Go down to verse 11, 12, 13, and 14. Start there. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. Can you do that? Can you? Can you do that? Can you wash somebody else's feet? Can you do it? Can you pick up the phone and say, I'm sorry? Or can we meet for coffee? Can you do it? I find it difficult for me. I by nature am not a feet washer. I have found that out. I'm more reserved, more careful, more calculating. But here we see Jesus really going out. And I think it's because he knew where he came from, where he was going, and he knew that he had so much power, and he wanted to teach them. And I think that mentality is in us too. That you know where you came from, you know who you are, you learn love, and you learn grace, and you learn to serve, you learn to reach out without hypocrisy and not a program, but you learn to do this because it is the mind of Christ. It's Christ's mind to wash one another's feet. Here's an interesting story. I work with a great staff of men and women in Baltimore. They are the greatest people I've ever worked with. They are amazing people. And they are like high quality people. And we have all kinds, wide variety of people as well. But they're amazing people. And Pastor Jomie is one of them. He's one of the trustees in our church. And we're very thankful for him. And all the people that we work with. And it's sometimes you might think, I don't need to wash their feet because they're such great people. But actually, it's not true. We need to wash one another's feet because we aren't really great people. Because we're like everybody else. Because we fail also. Because we need to be loved too. You never grow out of the need to be loved and given grace. You never grow out, you never become like a perfect group of people without any error, without any mistakes. Usually pride comes in when you feel that everything is so great and perfect. And it's awesome when you need to get down on your knees. And it's awesome to say, can I help you? How can I serve you? Can I meet you? Could I visit you? Can I love you? And then we are, as a church, surrounded by people with needs. And the phone rings in the middle of the night, or there's a great need over there. And it is a joy when you and I, as a habit, learn to serve one another and to wash the feet of each other. Your feet may not be washed by them, but that is not the issue. It's, can you wash their feet? Yeah, I'll wash their feet, but they got to wash mine first. Yeah, they can wash mine twice, then I'll wash theirs once. Many calculations, many evaluations, many searching for justice. You know, what he did to me shouldn't have never happened. It should have never happened. It's like, of course it should not have happened. In a perfect world, it would not have happened. But we are not in a perfect world. This is the world that Christ came to and taught us. In an imperfect world, you are to get down on your knees and wash the feet of the person that offended you, to love them and serve them out of the wealth of your edification. You are edified because you, beloved brethren, but you building up yourself in the most holy faith. You being edified in a deep way in the church are able to go out. There's a story that I have. A brother in our church in Baltimore, his neighbor sued him. He invited him over. When he went through the door, something broke, and it was like sounded strange to me, but the man brought the neighbor to court to sue him, and incredibly, the man won the lawsuit, and he got $1,500 from his neighbor, and so the neighbor is living right next door. And I said, "What did you do?" He said, "I told my wife we need to love him, and we must forgive him and just love him anyway." And my wife did not agree with me, and she was angry with the neighbor. I just kind of refused to like talk to them and even look in their direction. And he said this, he said, "I went over after I paid the money, and it was just totally wrong, unjust. But," he said, "I took it from God, and I understood something that God wanted me to do because God spoke to my heart." And he said, "Love that person." And so I went over and I just loved them, and I gave them small little things, and I would speak to him and love him. Years later, this man, the neighbor, would do this as a habit. He would move and he would sue his neighbors. It was like at the end, years later, I think it was 5 years later, his mother had died. The man was alone. He had no friends. And he came to him and he said, "You're the only man that ever showed any kind of care for me. And I just come to you because I'm totally depressed. I lost my mother. I've lost everything." And when he told me the story, I thought about the Christian life like this one. I know that everything is put into my hands, Jesus said. I know I came from God and I go back to God. So I can wash the feet. I can get down on my knees. I can hang on a cross. I can take the sins of the world. And then we expect it from him, but surprisingly he said it to us. He said, "You must do this. You must learn to think the way I do." And the enemy, Pastor O'Toole, could you just stand up again? And the enemy will be okay now. Okay, and the enemy will come as close to just to breathe on your neck. The enemy breathing on your neck, mocking you. And just enjoying the betrayal. But that does not stop Christ from being Christ, and it doesn't stop you from being you. That cannot challenge the kingdom, that breath of evil, that lie, that slander. That cannot stop you from loving. That cannot stop you from serving and being who you are and being edified. Okay, lastly, thanks, Pastor. It says here, verse 15, "I've given you an example that you should do as I have done to you." Could we read that out loud? "I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you." Let's do it again. "I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. One more time. I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. That sounds like body life is where we are learning this and doing this to each other. Aquila and Priscilla, and Paul loved them. I was saying in the van as we came here tonight that we called our first daughter Bethany. And I said, I felt when she was being born that God gave me the name. And my wife said, why that name? I said, Bethany was a village where Jesus would go to rest. And Lazarus and Martha and Mary, that family, was a place where he could find a bit of refuge in that family, in that village of Bethany. And it was where the oil was broken open and poured on his body. Also where he ascended up. There's two accounts. Well, Olivet and Bethany are very close to each other, from the Mount of Olives, and the other one from Bethany. And I said, I think this little girl will be for us and our family a place of rest for us. And it's happened. She's 36 years old, and for my wife and I, a place, a woman that we find this kind of love and warmth and fellowship and service. And it's the same for us in the body. When you learn to wash feet, people will come. When we learn to serve each other, people will come. And sometimes people with very deep problems, where they come. We had a woman in Finland, she would come at the late in the service, sit in the back, and before the song was over, she'd go out the door. And nobody knew who she was. And after some years, I said, does anybody know who that woman is? And everybody said, we don't know, but she will come in late and go out. And then it happened. Like the change started to happen. And she moved from the last row, she moved up about 10 rows. And then she would stay a little longer. And then finally she just stayed and she found. And I think washing feet is an important part of body life. Everybody needs it. Everybody needs it. Verse 16, verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. Now the last verse, 17, if you know these things, happy are you if you do them. It's interesting, isn't it, that last sentence? If you know the thing, that's one thing. But if you do what you know, that's another thing. It's one thing if you do it, if you know this, that's great, you know it. But if you practice it, that's even greater. You will be blessed if you do it. You might know it. I know I should wash the feet, but what he did to me, I can never forgive him. I know I should wash the feet. I know I should be a better believer. I know that maybe I should do this, but I will not. I will not. If you know it, that's great. But it's even greater if you and I will do it. It'll bring a revival. It'll touch people that'll never be touched otherwise. People know there's a lot of words in life, but they need somebody on their knees with a towel and with water and loving, and nobody sees it, but it is happening in the heart of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ's mind and heart is like this. And I believe this is why we have the revival happening in India. I believe this is why Pastor Carl's been used by God to be a wise master builder. And having this skill of loving somebody, edifying them, and then putting them somewhere and saying, you can do this. God is with you, or saying, sit here for a while and receive and be edified, and my eye is on you. This pastor, his eye is on you, and he cares for you. And I just see it growing with the other pastors, and the insight and the care and the service and the carefulness and the prayer and the love. We see it happening. We are amazed by that. And I believe Pastor Rajan has that same heart in Nepal, and Pastor Narj, the pastors that have come from Nepal. It's amazing. And on we can go. We see it all week. And I just think it's because not only you know these things, but you're actually able to lose your life and do them and find God in it. God is in it. God is in the forgiveness. God is in the edification. God is in the words. God is in God. The Holy Spirit is in our hearts. God is doing it, and he won't stop. I just know, of course he will not. We just know that he will not. That's amazing. Thank you, Lord, teaching us. Thank you, Lord, help us. Amen. Would you pray with me? Lord, thank you. We have learned a lesson, thinking about it in our hearts. And then happy will we be if we do it. And we need to learn it. We know that Judas Iscariot is busy in his way. That way is not our way. We are busy in this way. And as close as he may get to us, it will not affect us, because we'll just keep doing what it is that you want us to do. And we will be blessed in it. And you will take care of us. You will deliver us from evil. You'll set us on a rock higher than ourselves. You'll anoint us with fresh oil. You'll call us by name. You'll take care of us. We will edify others. We will love our enemies and pray for them that persecute us. And we'll see somebody like the Apostle Paul, who was a bad man, become an apostle, a great man. We'll see sometimes a change happen because of love, and we will see this. Thank you for the work in Orissa. Pour your blessing on it. Pour your spirit out on India, all over the country. This one flock, the body of Christ, working and ministering in many ways throughout the country. Thank you, Lord. Teach us and lead us in it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
That subject first. Anyone have a question or comment about that? Learning. He, in his heart, wants people to learn to think with God. And this is the word of God. It was very good. On Hebrews 4:12 and Hosea 6:5. And 2 Corinthians 10 was excellent. Thank you, Lord.
We actually wanted to ask you to, like, maybe comment on, like teach us a little bit about meditation. And actually, this is how my thoughts were led into that subject, but we'd like to hear from you, like, how to meditate. You know, some of our men, they raised up that question. We'd love you to comment on that.
How many of you find your lives very busy, full of activity, and maybe you don't have a lot of time? How do you live? Do you find you don't have a lot of time in your daily life? Okay, not many. You got a lot of time? Wow, that's amazing. I envy you. Oh no, I got all kinds of time. Oh, yeah. No problem. How much time you need? Okay, our minds, as was pointed out, It's really an amazing gift. It's awesome, the human mind and what we're capable of. And the Holy Spirit is really the one that uses our mind in bringing us understanding. And in the Bible it says, like, once you when you start to understand, understanding increases. And this is a joy for us, that we learn and then we learn more on the right premise. And this is our faith in God. I'll give you just a practical lesson on it that maybe will be helpful. I decide that I'm going to learn this book. So it's a lot to learn. So I'm going to be very patient and it'll take me a long time. But I will concentrate on small parts and reiterate them and think about them. I'll read books about them. I'll also read the text. And maybe I'll take, let's say, the book of Hosea. Does anyone here know about the book of Hosea? Okay, a few people. You can read the book, chapter 1, and read the chapter 20 times. You can read it slow, you can read it fast, you can underline words in chapter 1, you can read some commentary about it, meditate on it. You can take one verse out of Hosea chapter 1, or two verses, meditate upon them, write them on a piece of paper, put the paper in your pocket, and during when you're on the bus, or you're walking, or you're at work, or just pull it out, read it, and put it back in your pocket. And this is a little short lesson on meditation. And there will be times when it won't be interesting to you, and then there will be times when the word is very takes life. And you get a small segment of a verse that is alive. It's like food for you. When you pray now, like, where does your mind go when you pray? My mind may wander all over the place. But now I have a focal point, Hosea chapter 1. I put my mind on Hosea chapter 1 and I pray with the word. I am praying and my mind is on Hosea 1 because I have read it 20 times and I'm thinking about it. And I do this for 1 week or 2 weeks or even longer. There are things that God spoke to my heart last December that I'm still thinking about today. And some of the things that I said today, or I've been part of through the week, are things that I really enjoyed understanding last fall. This another point about meditation is your mouth. What you say. Do you have power with your mouth? The Bible says your mouth is a tree of life. Your mouth is a well, a fountain. What you say with your mouth is, it can be very powerful. Not a preacher, but just simply a believer. What I say to myself, that's called self-talk. How do I speak to myself? What do I think about myself? Has anybody here, I'm going to say this, I can't say this in America, but is anybody here fat? And I don't see anybody, that's why I can say it. Okay. But a fat person could be talking to themselves all day long, I am fat. I am fat. I am ugly. I am a failure. I'm a nobody. It's like those words are bad words. Those words are not true words. Those words are not edifying words. These are not important words. What you look like or how much you weigh or what you've achieved or accomplished in your life. You are called to another mind. And this is the mind where you want to meditate on the word. And the word will give you life. The word will speak. The word will change your life. And when you say it, even in your own home or your bedroom, and you start to meditate on it, and God gives you answers for your heart. When you suffer, He will speak to your heart. When you're unhappy, he can speak to your heart. When you're lonely, he speaks to your heart. I like what Pastor Devendra said. I'll say it this way. God is always speaking. He really is. But to most people, he's never speaking. Why? Because they're filled with their own thoughts. And those are not the thoughts of God. My thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. So would you stop it with your ways and your thoughts and learn of me? I am meek and lowly. Take my yoke, it is easy, and my burden, it is light. And learn to meditate on what I say, and I'll change your way of thinking, your life. You still be who you are. You still can do whatever. I mean, you have your life, but you learn another way that is encouraging to you and helping you. So read the book, and then read it fast, read it quickly, read it slowly, concentrate on it. I have a problem concentrating. I'll read the first verse, read the second, the third. By the third verse, I don't remember what the first verse said. I read the fourth and the fifth verse, and then I can't remember what the third verse was. I have a problem with that. But I've learned to say no. As I'm reading the third verse, I'm trying to remember what was the first verse. And as I read the seventh verse, I'm trying to remember what is it saying. And if I can't figure it out, then I might turn to a part that I do understand better, and I read that. But I can go back to it, and little by little, and meditating. Then Proverbs 22:18, the word will be fitted in your mouth, and then you'll say it with it to a sister or a brother. And learn how to share. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. I don't want to give you the impression that I got it all figured out and I do a lot. I do it, and I have done it all my Christian life, 40 years, and I'm excited about it, but I'm also, I'm just young at it, and I'm not really, there's no method. I cannot figure it out. I do not know how it really works. But I believe in principle, if I want to learn Hosea, the book of Hosea, then I'll read it 20 or 40 times. And I'll read it maybe right through if I can. And it takes time. It takes an hour, 2 hours. I sometimes enjoy, if I have 4 hours, and I can just be alone with my Bible and go through the Bible. I just love it. It's honey to my, it's honey. It's light. I love it. And at other times, to be honest, I get filled with my activities. I get filled with cares and concerns and worries. And I get filled with psychic noise. And I get troubled in my soul like everybody. And I get confused, and I get troubled, and I worry, and I have my, like all of us as people, but I also know where to go and be still and know that I am God, and let me say something to your heart. Another thing for me, in my case, sometimes I study to preach, but I love it when I just study not to preach. I love it when I just study to get a word. Like God kissed me with the kisses of his mouth and loved me. Sometimes I sit down in a quiet place and I just say in my heart, pour your love on me, Lord. Love me. I need it. I need you to love me. And there may be silence. There may be silence, but I say in my heart, I trust you. And I walk by faith in you. So those are a few words.
Just a brief comment on this, be still and know that I am God. I recently read it from one of the authors, Philip Yancey, on prayer, and he said this phrase, be still, in Latin, this word is vacate. Like the root word is can be translated into vacate, and from vacate we get this word vacation. And be still and know that I am God. can be also thought of in this way, that God is inviting us for a vacation with Him. That's a good definition for prayer, like stillness of my soul, like God is saying, come on, like it's time to just maybe pause and like come with me and listen to me, listen to the voice of love and receive it into your heart.
I'll tell you this story. Pastor Hadley, maybe many of you know the Baltimore Church. And by the way, thank you for coming to Baltimore last summer. I think there were 28 Indians and Nepali folks came, and that was a blessing to have you. Also, I remember Lester, we met at the airport, and he was buying a laptop so he could listen to Grace Hour, and that was a blessing to me, you know. And I thank you for that, like the connection that we have. Pastor Hadley, maybe you know him, anybody know Pastor Hadley, John Elliott? He had a beautiful daughter, 19-year-old woman, a young girl, beautiful in every way. She was just a gifted young girl, and she was killed in a car accident a few years ago. And he told me, just the other day, he said he would go home and just cry, you know, and then he would be alone, and he'd just cry out to God, and then he would just say, God, I trust you, and I'm just listening to you. And he would say that God never failed to speak to him. He said that that's how he went through that trial. And if you saw him go through it, you know, you would say, I could never do that. You know, that was, you know, I was amazed. And others have gone through similar things. But I think this is important because I don't think we can do these things. But I think God is saying, I am, you, by the way, this is the only religion where God talks to people. This is the only one. In Islam, it doesn't, he's not talking to you. In Buddhism and Hinduism and so on. This is the one where he's talking to you. This is the one where this book is alive. This is the one where he kisses you with the kisses of his mouth. And this is how we live. And Jesus said, man doesn't live by bread only, but by every word that comes from his mouth. And that's why as a church, and these pastors that are teaching their people the Bible, you're actually teaching people to hear from God. Because of Isaiah 30, verse 20. Would you like to turn there? This is a beautiful portion. Isaiah 30. For though the Lord give you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet shall not your teachers be removed into a corner anymore. But your eyes shall see your teachers. Can't we say that about the people, you know, that we are doing, that we have here this week, and the people in Orissa and in Delhi and so on, that the teachers are in front of our eyes. But they are not the essence. They are the teacher sent from God. But verse 21, your ears shall hear a word behind you. So your teacher is in front of you, but the word is behind you. Why is it behind you? Because it's God behind you that is talking to you, the word. But the teacher is there. Yeah, the teacher's there, but he's almost becoming invisible. Because I'm hearing a word behind me saying, this is the way, walk in it. And if the people, the churches in India are churches where people are hearing from God and he's telling them, this is the way, walk in it, the way of righteousness, the way of faith. And this is a Word of God revival. A Word of God revival is when just common people like you and I are hearing from the uncommon God. The Holy God is talking to us, and we're hearing Him. Words of faith, words of encouragement, words of love, words of a new identity. I am not my sin. I am not my sin. You know, I know who I am. I know where I came from and where I'm going. This is a work of grace. God wants you to know who you really are. Not who the world says you are, but who you really are. This is our treasure that God is speaking to us about who we really are. I'm reminded of a story of a beautiful woman from Kazakhstan. I heard this story in New York City. This is what happened. She was a naturally beautiful woman. And an advertising company from Britain found her and wanted to hire her as a model. And so her mother didn't want her to do it. But the money and the opportunity and everything, so she went to the UK and she started in her new life. She ended up in New York City, and she jumped from a high building to her death one day. And I thought about what happened, you know, in the story. She was 19 years old. The world saw value in her, you know. But she was probably like a child and probably didn't know who she was, and ends up on drugs and in depression, and ends up doing something foolish and taking her life. And you can cry, you know, when you think about how people live without knowing who they are. You know, who am I? Who am I? They say I am beautiful or something, but what is that? Like, really, who cares? If I can't find who I really am, and, you know, who is going to really tell me who I am? That's why there's so much pain and tragedy in the world. And there's a lost person. But for you, your teachers will be in front of you, talking to you. But they don't have the power, the voice. They don't have the ability to affect you, but a voice behind you, He will affect you. And He will say, this is the way, and walk in it. There is a famine in the world. It's not a famine of bread. It's a famine of the Word of God. This is the life-changing power of God. You know? Thank you for giving it to us, Lord. I can't believe it. I'm so thankful for it. It has made all the difference in my life, in your life. It's amazing.
Yeah, I have a question, but before that, I just wanted to make a statement that I'm sitting in this room and we're seeing what's going on in Orissa, and you know, I'm just honestly not with a false humility to say I don't know how I got here. I don't deserve, really, honestly, to be around men like this. And but then you realize that, you know what, God has placed us here. God has called us here. God wants us to, you know, this is not an accident that each person in this room is here. And you know, we have been really honestly blessed to be called into a great work. And it is a real privilege. It's almost like, you know, you wake up and you see, wow, this is like, how did I get here? And it's all by grace. It's all in His plan. And Pastor Schaller, that was an awesome message tonight. In fact, I can't even really put it in words, but it was almost like, you know, that we hear our value from Christ, from the Word, and we see it demonstrated in the lives of people around us. And you know, and God really wants to speak to us. And so I have this one question that was given. It's in Luke 6:38, and honestly, it'd be sitting next to you, Pastor Devendra, the message. And it's awesome. Luke 6:38 says, states that give and it will be given unto you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. And is it wrong to give expecting to have you given back by the Lord? Is the essence of my giving lost if I expect God to bless me and I give? What should be the motivation behind giving? Well, I think that, God knows our need, and He is a God of all grace. And I don't think there's a right and wrong answer here. You know, if you walk a block to get a drink of water, and because you are very, very thirsty, you're not to be condemned by walking that block to get a drink of water and expecting that I will get something for the walking there. I don't think there's a really right and wrong on that. I could give a quick answer. I can say I've never given for that, for that reason. But I think true giving is motivated out of a heart of love. And, without an expectancy. But I do know that there's a spiritual law behind it. And as you give out a heart of love, being motivated by the Holy Spirit, that it will be pressed down, it will be shaken together, and men will bring it to your bosom. And but there's much more riches, okay, than just you can put into a bank account. It's an example, we may get very, gifts, okay? Like, you know, somebody may give you an iPad. Getting my pads and pods right, but they may give you an iPad, and, you know, that costs more, okay, than, you know, maybe a new bicycle for your child. And that bicycle, okay, will be used and be appreciated for the child, and it will rust, be gone away. But what will never be gone away is a smile on the child's face of that gift being given to him. It is really, I went to a traditional church growing up. It was an Anglican church, and they didn't hear much of the Word of God, and there was never a salvation message. But there was a true statement, and that he said every week, it is more blessed to give than receive. And you know what? And that's biblical. And so, and God, He is a God of all grace. And but this principle does hand through. I hope that answers the question.
Pastor Devendra mentioned our identity, to know more a little bit about our identity. And then this paper says they want to know more about deep edification. If Jesus was to walk up to you and look in your soul, if Jesus was to look with His eyes right through you and look at your hearts and know you. Would you like that? Would you want to run and hide? If God was in that room right there and he called you and said, would you come? I would go get so-and-so. Would you go? Would you go in that room and meet God? What do you think? Yeah, you would, because you are his children. And yet, what would you feel like if God was in that room and he said, come and see, come to me. I want to see you. I want to look at you. I'm going to talk to you. What would you feel? Like, it's kind of like good, but also it could be a little bit scary, a little insecurity, right? A little bit. But what is better, not to go or to go? It's better to go. And you know what will happen? You will be deeply edified. That's what will happen. And in Revelation chapters 2 and 3, this is really what happened in the churches. Jesus went to those churches and he looked at the churches and then he spoke about with them and what is going on in the church. In the churches, you know the names of those cities. The churches were named by the cities they were in. Ephesus and Smyrna and Thyatira, Pergamos, Sardis, Laodicea, Philadelphia. And everyone, it was like his eyes are there. Now, this is edification. This is very good. And when you go from church, I feel this way. If it's an edifying church in a deep way, sometimes you will go from the church with some tears, a little bit in your heart, you know. You will go from the church saying, there's something in my heart that God is dealing with, and I like that. I'm going to go back. But some people, they think of a church as a little bit of like having a fun time. Like sometimes people think, I go to the church and we sing loud and we have a fun time and we rejoice. And I agree with that, but it doesn't always edify me, to be honest. I need sometimes something deeper. I need God to look into my heart where nobody goes. Nobody goes there. Nobody really knows me, but he does. And when he points out something to me, and he speaks to me lovingly, I am edified. I am. And you know, you may not have a capacity, like remember when Jesus met Peter after he denied him? This is deep edification. But Peter kind of superficially responded to Jesus. Jesus said, do you love me? And Jesus is wants a deep answer, like, I love you. But Peter didn't have the capacity. And, you know, he was like his friend. Jesus was like a friend and I am okay type of thing. But, and that's another message. But the point is that I feel that when you get deep edification, you just say, that is amazing. And somebody would say, do you want to go to the movie? Like a movie is a good movie. You could say, a movie is okay. You know, a movie has its place. But it's not what I experienced in the body of Christ, in the personal word of God to my heart. Do you want to go to the theater? Do you want to go to the library? Do you want to search the internet? Do you want to go with your, you know, girlfriend or do something or however it goes, all those things. And we say, yeah, that's all part of life. But there's one thing I really know that I need, and that's deep edification. For God to look into my heart and say, I love you. I am for you. I am with you. You have no idea how much you mean to me. For God to love me, and also for God to correct me and for me to have some sorrow that is godly sorrow. There's a sorrow in the world, and then there is a sorrow that is godly. And when it's godly, it motivates you. That's 2 Corinthians 7:10. Yeah, so that's the answer then. Yes.
So today's message was really heart-touching, and I want to just thank you for the message today. But I want to just comment on what you said today, a little comment, and you can elaborate on this. One thing you shared today was Jesus knew who he was. That made him easy to serve people, and also that's true, isn't it? Identity. Identity is not what we do. Identity is not what is my works before people. My identity is who Christ is and what is my place in Christ. And into that aspect of when we know that whole John 13 principle, but doing it becomes difficult. And we as a church, we have a lot of young people growing, and many times when people come in into the leadership and people are growing and all, so there's always identity crisis. I mean to say, like, no, I am identified because I am doing something, but my identity is in Christ. That becomes easy to serve. So can you just more comment on that and help us, all of us? I think many of us may not ask this question, but I think it's in everybody's heart. Can you just talk about it more?
Yeah, you're right. We could talk about it all night, all week, all year. It's very important. I'll just tell you a short story, and I know that you're going to go in a few minutes, so I'm happy about how you're going to have something to eat tonight and fellowship together. So I'm. Yeah, but let's just park on that point for a moment before we go. Identity. I'll tell you this story. I've told it in Baltimore. There's a big guy. He's like 2 meters tall and weighs 150 kilos. And he's a big, strong guy. Before he was saved, he was a bad guy. And he had a bar room. He also sold drugs in Baltimore. Also was a rugby player. He told me the reason I played rugby is so I could hurt people. You know, I was just a bad guy. Like I would play the game just so I could hurt people. I ran a bar room. I ran wild. I was fast moving. I traveled in certain circles. I was a bad guy. I came to Dr. Stevens' church and I got saved. And Jesus took away my sin and I knew I was born again. But I had a problem because I was an alcoholic and a drinker. And I identified myself as an alcoholic and as a bad guy. And God had to teach me a new identity. And he said, that's why I come to this church, because you always make it clear to me who I really am. I am not a bad guy, I am a child of God. And this identity has saved my life. He said, the last time I drank, I woke up in a helicopter, because he drank, he doesn't remember anything after that. He got in a car, he drove the car, he was in an accident. It was so bad that they medevaced him to the hospital to save his life. And he said, I have no idea what happened. And he said, that's what will happen to me if I drink. And I come to this church because you tell me who I am. And also, you do not drink here. You don't drink, and I need to be around people that do not drink. And I work in Chicago, like he goes from Baltimore to Chicago. And in the hotel, the people he works with say, come, let's go have a drink. And he said, I can't. I have a new identity. I refuse to do it. I can't. So I go to my room by myself. And sometimes it is lonely. And I have temptation. But he said, if I drink, I don't know if I will end up dead. I don't know if I will lose my wife. I will lose my children. I will go to prison. I don't know what will happen to me. So my life, I must live based on my new identity. And I know who I really am because I am not that person. I am this one. And it is amazing who he is. He is clean. He is edifying. He evangelizes. He loves his wife and his children. And he's doing a great job as a father. His life is totally different from what it would be. Because that identity is our DNA. Our new DNA. God gave us a new life. It's new DNA. We are not our sin. We are different now. And we have the mind of Christ. And if you sit and talk to this man, you recognize he has the mind of Christ. And this is a great testimony. And just to close with that, Pastor Kishore, that in the pulpit, and Pastor Devender said it tonight, it's like this is what we must impress upon people. And I think the poor people of India are a good example of an amazing resource from God. God has, because he takes people that may not think so highly of themselves, and all their life they may be looking down on themselves because they feel they are inferior, or they are told they are, or their family tells them they are, whatever it happens. I don't know and I don't care, because they are not. They are these people. They are these amazing people. They have the living God in them. They have the mind of Christ. They have authority from God. And they must learn who they are. And if that happens, you have an amazing movement of love. People that live in love and do great things. Gideon said, not me. I'm the least in my father's house of a tribe that is the smallest and the least in Israel. And the angel said, oh, Gideon, you are a valiant man of God. You are a man of God. Oh, Gideon, you are, what did he call it? The sword of the Lord. You are the sword of the Lord. You are a valiant man. The Ruth book, young woman, small, little Moabitess, young, small, little woman becomes very important in God's plan. Don't underestimate your value and your purpose. You are on the earth for a great purpose, and learn to walk in that. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.